project I'm going to talk about is looking at sustainability research. So these are, again, kind of thinking the terms you were hearing in the last talk. Disasters happen. We'd like to be able to model, when we know what the rainfall is going to be, what's going to happen, you know, when we know on the ground, what rivers are going to go up, how high, what's the short-term and long-term impacts of that, even out to are there policies we could make now and building codes and so on, do they really have an impact or not, and can we get that into the hands of decision makers to make this all go? There are a lot of interesting things in that kind of science that it's not really single discipline. You can't just know about rivers and understand what's going to happen to people along the river, because you need to understand why do people live near rivers in the first place, what kinds of building codes and insurance things are either driving people towards or away from the river. So these guys have to work across disciplines. They have to work across databases. They have to work across data types. We've got a really hard challenge to be able to do that. The timescales go from very, very short up to 50, 100 years, because you're talking about planning cycles and building lifetimes. So you've got things going from the weather changing day to day on up. Again, nobody models that well. You've got natural and human systems interacting, so you can't just take either in isolation. And you really have to kind of build from these very physical environmental things up through what society can work and the agents on top. So it's very broad and sweeping, but really they need to pull all of the data and all the calculation together. There are a lot of challenges in there, and this is just kind of giving you an overview of people who use anything from satellite remote sensing data to planes flying over and getting laser altimetry, basically LiDAR data to know how tall things are, to independent vehicles and autonomous vehicles, sensors in the field, models of the whole thing. People who have cranes and think about the world in terms of how far you are from a tree, and other things. People think of GPS coordinates and what the satellite sees, and which coordinate transformations. All sorts of fun stuff in here, and people are, again, really trying to get this, what's happening in an entire watershed, or how do watersheds differ across the country is kind of where we're going. It's not sensor by sensor, or look at this and see if I can model that, and really want to look at this big picture. So the project that we're putting together, it's part of NSF's DataNet project, which is trying to basically support this kind of wide-ranging science by gathering the data and the modeling capabilities, but then also preserving this data sort of in perpetuity. Right? How are we going to keep this data around if it's about climate change or it's about policy decisions, and we need to know why did people 50 years ago make this policy decision and should we be making different changes now? You need to keep this stuff around. You can't rely on 3 years of funding that somebody took a lot of data and then disappears somewhere. So this is to basically deal with how can we help sustainability researchers and how can we kind of pull that into a curation and preservation paradigm in a way that we can keep it going. Without giving any more pitch about the project, what that turns into on the ground is we're really looking at semantic content middleware. Basically, key blobs that look like files and keep a lot of RDF relationships with that data to anything else you want. So, paired relational database, think of essentially we're saying that anytime you want to add a column and tell me something else about that blob of information, you can go add a column and keep on going. So we sort of have a big graph of related things, and then we've got anything from we've got sort of sensor data coming in from the field. You can run workflows on the far side that take that data, produce some derived data or some model data and throw that back in here. We've got a Flickr-style interface called Apigee that's over the top of this that lets you see the data. If it's an image, we call it Microsoft's zoomable image viewer, Sea Dragon stuff, so you drop an image in and immediately get a zoomable view. You can tag and license and so on down the side. You can comment on it. If it's a photo, we can pull out the metadata inside with the GPS location and so on. But there are lots of other data types we can't do anything with, so data plugins, anybody wants to do one, we'd love to have it. We're also tying in Vivo, which has been called a Facebook for science, but it's really sort of a, if you're a faculty member, what are your projects, what are your interests, what department are you in, what publications do you have, what data sets do you have available, what sources, what codes do you work with. That whole mess of connections there, we now want to tie across. So you can say, actually, this data was published in that paper. That guy does the same kind of research as that guy. He's got another data set and want to be able to walk back and forth. So trying to walk back and forth between these tools. And the same thing, putting sort of geospatial kind of front ends on this stuff where if I drop my shape file with geospatial information in Geechee, that looks just like all the other data sets that are out there from the reference stuff. So I can go to a Google Maps kind of interface and say, show me my data overlay from the reference data and see it all over there. Or show me all the data that I've tagged with interesting in my project over here in Geechee, so that I don't have to look through 100,000 data sets. I can just get the ones that are already tagged that are relevant to me and kind of move it back and forth. And then finally, for the curation part of this, is now you've got this big graph of sort of everything you know. It's all of the applications are basically making pointers out in RDF so that at least somebody else can walk along those pointers and you can use a walk them. To long term, we basically are doing things like lassoing part of this graph, turning it into one file, one package that then goes into an institutional repository that stores the file and make sure the bits stay, get it in a catalog and so on, and hand it off to librarians and kind of make all that stuff work together. So just in terms of buzzwords under there, a lot of environmental research is sort of long tail, so the same way that Amazon, you know, is trying to give you books that you wouldn't find in a bookstore. There are lots of people who have data about Three Lakes. They've got no money and no connection with anybody else to go put that out, so we're trying to say, well, you can put it out, make it easy enough, simple enough to get your data without having to go to a big standards body and figure out what metadata standards you can use for everything. Get it out there and sort of do this in a long term way. A lot of semantic stuff in there that I mentioned, linked data kind of mentality, sensor web kind of mentality, we're trying to connect sensors. Social networking is in there because we want all of the kind of discussions around the data to be captured and help us out. We did discovery and integrations in there. Once you get all this to do that curation, you're really doing reasoning and inference and all logical level stuff. We've got Web3, Google Widget Toolkit, Google Maps, EarthGIS kind of data in there. And I think there are lots of things that we don't have in the money that NSF has given us so far. So I think this is a great platform to think about electronic notebooks again. It's one of the challenges we had before is that anytime you build a notebook, the only way we could sort of point to the data was if you put the data in the notebook too. That just doesn't make sense. It's going into somebody else's database. And now we've got global IDs. We can think about the notes staying in sync with the data and underscore differently. It's time to rebuild that. Phone and tablet apps for field work, same things you just heard. You know, all of the researchers coming out of the field across the US need that. The amount of data that we're getting from satellites and complaints and so on is going up. So all of the traditional ways of analyzing these images, which either are Excel spreadsheets or it could be somebody just sitting there manually doing it, don't work, and you've got 700,000 images, so they all need to have throughput pipelines, they all need CCNI, they don't know it, so we've got to get them on that. Viewers, different kinds of data, ways to pull metadata out of different kinds of data, and again, this is, at some level, this all relates to that project, that one grant, but the whole idea of DataNet as well was to make this stuff that was going to be generalizable. So even though I've been talking about sustainability, all of the stuff that I've just talked about is not specific to GIS data or images or anything. It could be chemistry molecules, it could be 3D CAD drawings. And again, if you start tying that back to the idea of digital transferability, we're trying to get all of our data and stuff to work this way on campus. But nobody said that this is the infrastructure we're going to do for that. The same set of problems is to be great to kind of explore how much does this stuff actually do what we're going to do across lots of disciplines on campus. So there's lots of opportunities there as well. Okay, so if I haven't talked fast enough, ask me questions and I'll talk even faster. Thank you.
If students want to get involved in some of these projects, how do they contact and who the contact person is? Where do they see their website and so on?
So with the things I was just saying at the end, contact me. We don't have a website partly because we don't know that grant is really there, so these things are not real in that sense. A lot of the software that's involved actually does have websites back in NCSA, so if you call me or email me, I will point you to the details out there. For broader stuff, again, I'm happy to be, you know, if you want to do something in quantum chemistry and I don't do that, I'd be happy to try and find the right person.
Because I'm going to release for the fall project, so usually the students ask what kinds of projects should I do, so I think.